Here we go. Finally. That took a little doing. It was just for some reason today when I'm streaming, it's not connecting directly right away. So nice. We got our stream going. So we're all set. And this is stream number three for today. And again, we've called this math open discussion. Sort of give people an opportunity to drop in and review mathematics. If I can help you guys out, I will. But we did mainly math basically for the first stream earlier today at 9 a.m. For the second stream, I just presented a little data for our Monopoly that we've been collecting with our gaming group of how many wins and losses people have. And we made a table back here and we looked at that, and I'll present that information at some point. And towards the, I guess, midway through the last stream, there weren't any real math questions, and or there weren't any math questions, and I don't really want to teach anything right now. I'd rather just deal with questions, make an open discussion, because it's end of the year. So we started talking about comic books, and what I did was show you. I have a stack. I brought over a stack which is double this. So we looked through half the stack of what comic books. Hey, Index, how are you doing? What comic books I've read, and it was an hour, so we thought we'd go through the rest here. Hello, Ethan. Doing good, brother. Doing good. Welcome to the stream. And Index asked the question regarding cognitive. Blah, 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 where are we? Regarding streams of consciousness, narrative mode for comic book storytelling. And I had to look up what streams of consciousness is, and Hellblazer was one that came to mind. And I went to my bookshelf, and I was trying to find my Hellblazer trade. I have a couple of Hellblazer trades, but I couldn't find them. I've read a fair bit of Hellblazer, and I just wanted to make sure Hellblazer, John Constantine, did have a cognitive, what do you call it? Stream of consciousness narrative mode. And stream of consciousness narrative mode, I'm just gonna mention what it is again, Index, just because this is a new stream. It's gonna be loaded on differently than the previous one, previous stream. So I'm just gonna do a little recap. So Index asked if there was any comic books that I knew of that has, let me read this again, stream of consciousness narrative mode, right? And I had to look up stream of consciousness. Initially, I thought it was more to do with consciousness, definition of consciousness and whatnot. And stream of consciousness is this from the wiki page, right? It says in literary criticism, stream of consciousness is a narrative mode or method that attempts to depict the multitudinous thoughts and feelings which pass through the mind, right? So I'm assuming that's sort of the person talking. Chicho, Bot, Weasley, I thought I missed the stream. No, you haven't missed the stream. We're doing four streams today, right? This is number three. We did two streams, hour-long streams, sort of open discussion, math. But in the last stream, halfway through, we started talking about comic books. There wasn't anybody that wanted any math help, and I didn't really want to teach any math lessons. So we started. I brought out some comic books, showed you guys some comic books I've been reading. If you have any math questions, for sure post them. We'll cover it. But if there are no math questions, we'll just keep on talking about comic books or whatever, right? And basically, stream of consciousness narrative mode for storytelling. I'm assuming it's supposed to be the person talking about what they're feeling. And I know, I'm pretty sure, I try to find my Hellblazer trays that I have. I have the Hellblazer series, but I wanted to find the Hellblazer trays just to confirm, and I couldn't find them. So I pulled out some other comic books. And Index, correct me if I'm wrong, but Stream of Consciousness, I'm assuming one of the ones was Adventures of Barry Windn. And I have the whole collection here, but I pulled out the number one. Okay. And here's the link to the video we put out for Adventures of Barry Wynn. That should be it anyway. Let me make sure that takes you to the right place. Yeah, Adventures of Barry Wynn. And we read issue number one. And basically, I'm assuming stream of consciousness would be something like this, right? This is the first page. Okay, if you want to see, we did the reading of this first issue. Hopefully, that's the one. But it basically says this. This first page is brilliant, by the way, for Adventures of Barry Wynn. That's the trade. There's single issues for this. But basically, it's this guy, right? And I do actually have, let me, Adventures of Barry Wynn, on the pages of Adventures of Barry Wynn. I actually put an article together for Adventures of Barry Wynn. Let me post this as well, so you can see the actual page and you can confirm if this is what you mean by, let me read that phrase again, stream of consciousness narrative mode. So if you go, oh, interesting, I haven't seen that video. I'll have to watch it. Well, I don't know if this is what you mean, but if you click on the second link that takes you to Blogspot, and if you scroll down a little bit, there's, I scanned, basically, I scanned this first page, right? Let me make sure I'm showing up on Twitch. I scanned this first page and I have them double, okay? And it basically reads like this. I should probably start at the beginning. I was born a genius. And then there's a little word balloon coming up from Barry Wynn being born, right? And it says, Jesus, it's cold out here. And then the next thing here says, well, I was smart even before birth. And I'm not talking a little smart. I mean, way smart. Self-awareness in the womb smart. Whoa. Is this my, well, it keeps on going, right? So I'm not 100% sure if that's the style. Wow. Oh, wow. Yes, that's exactly the kind of thing I'm looking for. Perfect. Okay. Adventures of Barry Wynn, if you like humor, absolutely fantastic. You can read that first or watch the first video and read some of the pages. I, in that Blogspot, I posted some of the pages. It's not all like that. It's just the first page that was like that. Who's the author? The author is Judd Winnick. Okay. He did like three mini series of Barry Wynn for this. Okay. So that's one that I could find. So I couldn't find my Hellblazer. So I can't confirm Hellblazer is one. Okay. But Hellblazer, there was 300 issues of Hellblazer. And there's a lot of dialogue for Hellblazer with John Constantine saying what's happening and explaining things and stuff like that and his feelings, right? I don't know if it's in every issue, but I'm almost 100% positive Hellblazer definitely has stream of consciousness narrative mode, okay, if that is what you're looking for. Another one I found was this one, which is, I really enjoyed this, okay? Midnight Nation. I don't know if this is the case as well. Awesome, I'll check it out, thanks. I know it has parts of it. So for example, this is, you know, I flip a little bit in. So, you know, there's boxes, dialogue boxes, stating what it is. It says, suddenly I had my life back, but I didn't know what to do with it. What I was supposed to do, what I was supposed to be doing. So I asked them, heck, wasn't my doing? I was just laying around dead, not bothering anybody. He was responsible, right? So there's a little bit of that in Midnight Nation, okay? And the writer for this, the creator for this is Michael Straczewski, and he is, I don't think you can see it, and his work is amazing. I've read a fair bit of some of his stuff anyway. Another person is, it's the person that came about with comic book journalism. He gave birth to comic book journalism, and it's Joe Sacco. And because it's journalism, there's a lot of his perspective in the comic books, right? So it's more of a historical piece to a certain degree, but he does provide feelings and stuff, and it's political. So Midnight Nation is sort of, I don't know if it's horror, sort of post-apocalyptic. Hellblazer is considered to be horror to a certain degree. Barry Windham is humor, okay? Joe Sokol's work is comic book journalism, and it's historical. So, again, the dialogue, just reading one of the boxes. One of the women seems put off by my questioning, like, who am I to strut? Strut in with my Western patronizing air, right? So it's first person, he's talking, explaining what's going on with him. And if you can handle it, Joe Sokol's Palestine, okay? The sun is shining now, so the lighting might be a little weird, okay? Joe Sokol's Palestine, if you can handle it. I've only read about a third of it, and it's just heavy, very, 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 very heavy, okay? Another one of Joe Sokol's work. And we read a little bit of this, took a look at it, is Joe Sokol's The Fixer and Other War Stories. Fantastic. Okay. If you look at my comic book playlist, reading comics, papa, you'll find it, but let me get the link for you if you want. You can get a feel for it if this is what you're looking for, then. And if you want sort of historical history in terms of politics, and this Joe Sokol's The Fixer is about Sarajevo, okay? Fantastic read, and we read parts of it. All of it doesn't have dialogue box, but it does a fair bit. The television images serve up the essential truth. A city is trapped, its citizens shelled in their apartments and shot down in the streets by Serb nationalists who have already. So he gives a little historical background and he shares his feelings, what he's been going through. I mentioned Valiant Comics, okay? And Valiant Comics, my single issue of Book of Death, Fall of Bloodshot, I'm pretty sure Fall of Bloodshot fits into that category, and it's a fantastic read. For a single read, but I believe this is here. Let me show you this. This is the Divinity Omnibus. It basically puts together 3 4-issue miniseries comics that were put out by Valiant Comics called Divinity. Divinity 1, which was 4 issues, Divinity 2, which was 4 issues, Divinity 3, which was 4 issues, and then there's Divinity 0. Okay. And Divinity, this one, I don't know. The first three don't have it, but Divinity Zero is a first person. He's basically explaining what's going on. Let me read a dialogue box. Let me make sure I got Divinity Zero here. And it's a brilliant read, and the artwork is absolutely magnificent. It's painted. Painted work. Finally able to catch you live. I've been watching you on YouTube for a while. Awesome. Thanks for being here, Miles. We sort of, it was supposed to be open discussion about mathematics, but there isn't too many math questions coming in, so we're going into comic books. And right now, there's a question that Index asked if I could recommend any stream of consciousness narrative mode of storytelling for comic books. So I'm sort of going through that right now because initially I couldn't think of anything. But let me read you this one. This is basically, here's Divinity Zero, right? That's the one of the covers, and then it opens up here, the first page. But let me read you some of the dialogue box from the second page. Right? When I was younger, I would pore over each word, reading up, rereading every line. I would study the cover until I could recreate every detail with my eyes closed. There were fewer distractions then, seemingly limitless amounts of time, limitless possibilities. So it was no surprise to me that in 1960, the Soviets launched me into space on a top secret mission to the furthest reaches of the galaxy. I made the motherland proud. At the end of my journey, I encountered the fantastic and the terrible, something truly unknown. Whatever it was gave me the power to return home over 50 years later. Okay, and it continues on there. And Divinity Zero is sort of recapping Divinity 1, 2, and 3, 12 issues that came previously, but giving a Divinity's feelings and emotions and why he's going through the motion. Beautiful read, beautiful read, beautiful artwork. If you like science fiction, and this is categorized as science fiction, and superhero as well, but mainly science fiction, I cannot recommend this highly enough. Okay, beautiful, and it's a nice read, heavy read. Okay, here's the omnibus for Barry Wynn. This contains everything that he put out with Barry Wynn, if you like that, and it's fairly a cheap, inexpensive way to get all of the Barry Wynn story. It's all black and white. Okay, and it's not all like that, where he's giving his perspective. There's a dialogue box. I know issue one has it, but I don't think all the issues have it. Okay, so be warned on that. I'm reading March right now, and the narration is mostly John Lewis remembering his life. Cool. I still haven't read that, the March the March book, or the trade and singles or whatever they came out, right? Here's another one by Joe Sacco. Okay, this is conspiracy. If you like conspiracies, Joe Sacco's bump is brilliant. I don't think it has. What can we conclude from the fact that she does not? It doesn't have the dialogue. I don't think it's stream of consciousness narrative mode. I have to reread it every time. But it is Joe Sacco, and it is crazy. Okay, so those are the ones I could pull out in the little break that I had before the last stream, between this stream and the previous stream. And as far as single issues, there was somebody that asked me about single issues, fantastic reads. Okay, this is one that I mentioned, and I just pulled it off. Sky Doll. Okay, this is the sort of a trade collection that came out that put together two issues. It was like a two issue miniseries that came out. Absolutely brilliant science fiction. Okay, the artwork is, let me see if I can show you this, hopefully you can get an appreciation for how brilliant the artwork is. Okay, this doesn't have, that's great, quite a few things to check out. Yeah, hopefully they are. As for Sky Doll, it's not stream of consciousness narrative mode. It's just a single issue of a comic. Someone asked, you know, something that stands out by itself, is a beautiful read. I highly recommend this. Okay, if you haven't read this. If you want beautiful artwork, beautiful science fiction. Okay, so those are the ones that I could pull off Speedy Gonzales style, look for them. And I think Hellblazer is one as well. And I actually went to, let me put these guys away for now. So they're added away. And I went to Reddit, the comic book forum, and I posted a question. What are some good examples of streams of consciousness, narrative mode, and storytelling? I was hoping there'd be some comments, and there are. I mentioned Hellblazer in my post, okay? And someone here has mentioned here. Actually, I'll just read it to you. Some person here has mentioned Spider-Man Blue has some parts that could be labeled as such. Minor spoilers ahead. Okay. Most pre-modern age comics, I guess so. Oh, hey, da, da, da. They lift them. Yeah, and on comic book, someone's mentioning something else. That I was banned from the comic book forum on Reddit for posting a link to Valiant's Geomancer storyline because they said they were not going to publish it and stuff like this, and I got auto banned because it was a pirate site, and I was just like, dude, like, that's crazy. And I didn't unban me for a while, and then I found out I was unbanned. I don't know why, but maybe there's a time limit on it or something like this. So that's why I was able to post that thing there. Okay, and someone's, I have to reply to that person, saying, hey, you got unbanned. Because there were a couple of advocates trying to get me on unbanned, but the mods wouldn't have it, right? Censorship is insane. And I was okay being banned. It is what it is, right? There's lots of forums out there. But that is a good forum for comic books. It's very, very related to the big two, mainly Marvel and DC, and there's lots of just artwork, who did Discover variant covers and stuff like this, which is cool to look at. It's just not something that I'm collecting. So it's more of the mainstream level, right? And there are some nice posts being put up. For sure, there are some nice stuff. I don't want to trash talk it. There are, it's worth checking out, as well as some other forums. Hello, Kung. How are you doing? Kung Klatan. How's life? So we're doing comic book talk. Again, I'll put this out there. If there's anybody that has any math questions, for sure we'll do. But if there isn't, we'll continue with our comic book discussion and anything else that might come up. But one thing I should do is, in the last stream, I showed you guys. I hope that helps you out, the index. I hope that points you in the right direction. There's a lot. After I started looking at it, I'm like, man, I've read a gazillion comics that have. Oh, what is this thing again? Streams of consciousness narrative mode. There's a lot of them out there, and I've read a lot, and I actually enjoy it a lot because it gives you there's more substance to that type of storytelling because you get a feel for what the characters are going through, their state of mind, their emotional state, and what they've been through. You get history from them, so it is one of my preferred comic book reads. I just didn't know it was called Streams of Consciousness Narrative Mode. Wow, I remember that. Cool. Just had to read it like 20 times. So I've already shown you guys in the last stream these comics that I've been reading for the last little while. Okay, let me put these ones back. And here's these guys. Okay, I had a good eighth grade math teacher that showed me a stack of papers that a student wrote on a Googleplex. Googleplex on. It was like 10 pieces of paper. Googleplex. Why is that Googleplex? I don't know what that is. Is the number 10 or equivalent 10 written out in ordinary decimal notation? It is one followed by, that is, oh, I don't know this. Oh, this is Google. Is a number. Oh, okay, this is where Google got their name from, right? Googleplex. Googleplex. Oh yeah, that's right. Initially Google wanted to name it Google, but it didn't look nice, so they changed it to Google. He wrote out all of it in eighth grade. An eighth grade math teacher that showed me a stack of papers that a student wrote out a Google. He wrote out Googleplex, all of it, with all the zeros in there. That's crazy. The largest name number. And that's cool. That kid must have, how many pieces? 10 pieces of paper. I wonder how tight the zeros were, right? That's cool. That's cool. And the teacher kept it. I can't believe the student didn't keep it. That'd be cool to have as a teacher. Fun. I think it's fantastic that Google got their name from math, from the largest number that has a name, I believe, right? Is the number written out? Yeah, wherever we read it, I think it's the largest number that has a name, right? As far as the rest of the comic books I've been reading, let me show you these ones. Tank Girl, comic book, free comic book day. Tank Girl, I liked it. I like Tank Girl, I like the concept of Tank Girl. The artwork is zany, it's like little bits here and there. You know, sometimes it's just like that. Some of it was, I like this style the most for Tank Girl, where they do, you know, it's the background is sort of colored and this stuff like this. Okay, so this, a brief history of Tank Girl from Free Comic Book Day. It was fun, it was a good read. Okay, now I picked this one up too, Image First Moonshine, and I've read the first, I don't know how many issues of this. It took a huge pause. I was reading this, this was on my pull list, and then I think it got to issue number 5, and I read up to issue number 4 or 5 or 6 maybe, and then there was a huge pause for months, nothing came out, so I pulled it off my pull list. But I bought this for $1 just to have as a stack, just in case, you know, someone says, hey, do you have any crime sort of gangster stuff comic books that are well written? This would be it, Brian Azzarello's Moonshine. I like Brian Azzarello's work, well worth the read. I have Cinema Manga comics of actual SpongeBob episodes. Really? I've read some SpongeBobs. SpongeBob is fun. SpongeBob is fun. I love this first SpongeBob movie, and the episodes, the shows, the first 2 seasons are pretty good. Okay. Another one I read recently is True Believers. Okay, again, Wolverine. This one, it was whatever. It was it, the story I didn't mind. I liked the story. I wasn't too fond of the artwork. I don't know what the cover of this is. The reprint. Oh, it's a reprint of X-Men Deluxe. It's a reprint of this. Okay. What decade of cartoons is the best? What decade of cartoons is best? I think every decade has their phenomenal cartoons. The 90s had an amazing run of some fantastic comic book animation. Okay, Batman is one of them. The Max Spawn was really good. Max was fantastic. The Tick in the 90s was amazing. Oh, I have that one. There's a spread splash page, right? Yeah, there's a spread. This is like the, I guess, gatefold cover, right? And then there's a lot of, the story was good. The artwork, I didn't like it, that it was using up too much white space. They're trying to be really artistic about it. Like, I don't like reading the comics like this. What's the best movie adaptation? Best animation movie adaptation? Or best movie adaptation of a comic book? There's a few of them. Yeah, there's a lot of pages like this. So I didn't like the layout of the art for this. I like the art style. I didn't like the layout. Like, this one was just too much. I think it could have been presented better. But I did like the story with Sabretooth and Wolverine sort of just going at it, right? As far as best adaptation, movie adaptation of comic books, I like The Watchmen. I know a lot of people didn't like it. I like The Watchmen. I think it was really good. I like The History of Violence, even though the comic book was way more brutal than the movie. I thought the movie was very good. I liked the movie. I think it's the beginning of the Age of Apocalypse. This one is, eh? Is this one the beginning of the Age of Apocalypse? Possibly, I don't know. I can't remember. I can't go back. I can't remember that far. I would have to sit down and read them. But it is around that period, right? I read Game of Thrones. Okay, it was okay. The show is better. I don't know what the books are like. I haven't read the books, but I do like the show. And the comic book was basically recapping parts of the show. I think we need illogical people because they make the world interesting. They create stuff. Illogical. There's a lot of logical people that create amazing work as well. I think we need way more diversity in ways of being, consciousness, in ways of thought than we have. And one of the reasons that's the case is because we don't have that diversity as much as we should have in the mainstream, is because a lot of countries have outlawed certain ways of being, certain ways of thought, right? So governments have come into our lives and taken away liberty, saying you can't express yourself in this way. So I agree with you. I don't know if I would use the word illogical. I would use the word, what would I use? I don't know what I would use. Not annoyed by the sun. The sun? No, I like the sun. If we weren't doing a live stream, I get my whole body to get some sun, right? But unfortunately, I can't cut the sun off on this one because it's a skylight coming in, right? We don't have a what do you call it? The blocker. Visor, I don't, it's not a visor, but whatever set up for the skylight. So my apologies. Hopefully it's not annoying to you guys. The shadow effect is crazy. Whoop. Right. It is getting on. That's why I took off my toque. It's a different look. It's a different look. If I was shooting video, for sure I wouldn't do this. And I didn't know, because we're going into the summer, the sun is changing, and I wanted to do this all day. I hadn't planned on the sun being on me at this time, right? There are logical and illogical creative people. Take, for example, Andy Warhol, Weir, the author of The Martian. I don't know Andy Weir. I thought I was gonna read Andy Warhol. Andy Warhol was just a marketer. Andy Weir, the author of The Martian. Boop. Let me check this out. Andy Weir. Would you consider him to be illogical or logical? What else has he written? It doesn't look like I've read anything from him. Just checking it out. So, would you consider him to be logical or illogical, Miles? Another book I read was The Ultimates, number one. Marvel now. Generic. It was, I mean, I read it, but because I didn't read, this is Ultimates 2. Sorry, my apologies. Ultimates 2, right? The 2 is up here. So I hadn't read Ultimates, and this thing referred to Ultimates a lot. What happened during the Ultimates? It recaps some of it, but it was okay. It didn't really intrigue me too much. The artwork was so-so. So I couldn't recommend this. Inhumans versus X-Men, number 7. Read this one. The Martian was a very scientifically accurate book and movie. So would that be a logical modern Marvel? Yeah, that's Marvel now. This one was Marvel now. Right. Gross. Yeah. I would not recommend this. Yeah, that's funny. This one too. Inhumans versus X-Men. I wouldn't recommend. Hi, man. Hi, Osaka. Osaka 200. How are you doing? Welcome to a live stream. It was supposed to be math, but we're talking comic books. There was no math questions. And again, if anybody's here for mathematics, if you have math questions, let us know. We'll do some math. Okay? We'll take a break from comic books and do some math. But yeah, this one, it too many characters, too much of nothingness, really empty for me anyway. Redneck from Image Comics, definitely intrigued me. This is Image First. I believe I have the first issue of this, first two or three issues of this, but I didn't read them. They were on my pull list. Usually what I do, I add stuff to my pull list, and if I end up reading them after two or three issues, I keep them on there. If I don't, I take them off. And I didn't get a chance to read this, so when Image put it out for $1, I grabbed it and I read it, and it intrigued me. It was fun. It's just give you spoiler, it's basically vampire story, but in I guess, I don't know if it's a derogatory term or not, but well, I don't know, it's like a, redneck vampire story set in a small town. It was very good, fantastic read, and I like these types of stories, right? Sort of set up in the same place as, same style as Southern Bastards, right? What would you recommend for someone who hasn't read very many comic books? What kind of books do you want to read? Like, that's the thing. Comic books is like saying, what kind of book do you recommend? So my first question to you would be, do you want to read humor? Do you want to read horror? Do you want to read science fiction? Do you want to read crime? Do you want to read noir? Do you want to read superhero stories? Do you want to read historical pieces? What are you interested in, Miles? I could possibly recommend something. Here's another one that I picked up from Aftershock Comics and my comic book store, Sci-Fi. Here, Sci-Fi. And let me show you this. I don't know if you popped in earlier. Here's two books I brought out at the beginning of the stream to talk about. Let me see if I can say it without looking it up. I can't say it without looking it up. Streams of consciousness narrative mode. We're talking about that. First one would be pick up first good science fiction, heavy read, big read. Okay. Divinity by Valiant Comics. This is the omnibus. Contains basically 13 issues, and it's got some extra stuff in there as well. And it's basically Divinity 1 to 4, Divinity 1, Divinity 2, Divinity 3, and each one of those had four issues associated with it. And it's got Divinity 0, right, from Valiant Comics. Fantastic read. Really good sci-fi. Highly recommend this. Okay. Another sci-fi from Valiant Comics would be Rye. Pick up Rye, the first issue of the relaunch that came out. Fantastic science fiction. Beautiful science fiction with some amazing art, right? And it's spelled RAI, okay, from Valiant Comics. Fantastic. Another science fiction, which what I would really highly recommend, is Sky Doll. Okay. Sky Doll is beautiful. Okay. It's basically sort of like a other worlds. Divinity is related to Earth. Okay. So Divinity and Rye from Valiant Comics, they connect to Earth, right? They don't go galactic. Okay. Divinity does goes galactic a little bit, it comes back. This one is galactic. Okay. Multiple worlds, different types of creatures and all that jazz. Beautiful stuff. The artwork is mesmerizing. Okay. So Let me see if I can show this to you properly. Like, the artwork is beautiful. The first time I bought the single issues of this, and this is only two issues put together, right? When I bought the single issues, I read a little bit, but I just flipped through the pages just to look at the artwork. Very beautiful. Okay, if you like those recommendations, then you know, let me know. I'll recommend other things for you as well. Hi Chicho, could you please show two x minus one grading three on a number line? It was on my test and I realized I have forgotten how to do it. For sure. Okay guys, we're gonna take a little break from the comic books. We got this much to go through, and I'll show you a little mathematics. Let's do a little math. So 2x minus 1 greater than 3. We'll solve this and put it on a number line, okay? So I'm going to change the angle view. Let's put it here. So 2x minus 1 greater than 3. Let's bring out the pen. So basically, this is sort of, there's two different types of questions you can get. Now, well, when it comes to solving things, right? If you have an equal sign in mathematics, you're going to get an absolute value. X equaling something, that's it. Or X equaling a few different things, but they're at that dot, at that point. When you have inequalities, and that's what it is, inequalities, you're talking about zones, greater than, less than. And whenever I read these things, I always read it from the letter, right? So X is greater than, the opening is what I read. This opening is bigger than that. So bigger than, greater than, whatever number is here, let's say 2. Or X is, you're hitting the small one first, X is less than 2. You could write it here too, right? This would be X is greater than 2, X is less than 2, right? So just clear that, get that out of the way, right? As for the question is this, 2X is it minus 1? Yeah, the frame rate is better on this one. 2x minus 1 greater than 3. 2x minus 1 greater than 3. Yeah, the frame rate, this is an external camera that I have. The camera on the computer is not that great, but I'm using that one because this is where we're going to do the work. It's easier for me to read comments on the computer and have the camera using the computer camera. There are times where I set up, I got two of these external mics that I set it up, and I sometimes use that as well. And usually try to use the external ones, not the internal computer mic, right? Or camera. So to solve for this, basically what you gotta do is get X by itself. That's what it means to solve for an equation, right? So first thing you gotta do, you gotta undo what's being done to the X. So the X is being multiplied by 2 and 1 is being subtracted, right? So what we do, we grab this guy, bring it over first, which is basically add 1 on this side to kill the negative 1, so we add 1 here. So this kills this, right? Negative 1 plus 1 is 0, it's gone. So all we got left on this side is 2x is greater than 4, right? What we gotta do now is undo the x being multiplied by 2, and that's a division. So divide by 2, divide by 2. So x is greater than 2, right? And we need to put this on a number line. Now, usually they ask you to put it on a number line. Sometimes they don't. When you're starting out, they do. Later on in higher level mathematics, you don't need to put it on a number line. This is what it is. You don't have to state it visually. But to put this on a number line, basically draw a number line. And some teachers say, oh, you have to put your zero marker there and stuff like this. I don't, right? I put 2. So I put my marker and go, this is 2. X has to be greater than 2. And greater than 2 is this way, right? This side is all the numbers that are bigger than 2. So we know we're on this side. And this is only X is greater than 2. It doesn't have the equal to sign as well, right? If it had the equal to sign, we would make it a solid circle. But it doesn't include 2. So what we do, we do an open circle. And an open circle means it doesn't include this point, right? So X has got to be greater than 2, so you draw it this way. So any number from that's bigger than 2 satisfies this equation. And you can do a check on this as well if you want. Sometimes you're asked to do a check. So pick a number, any number that's bigger than 2, right? Let's say we pick 3. Okay. And if you want to put your 0 here, that would be 1. Here's your 0, right? Doesn't make a difference. So let's put the number 3 in our equation. So this is 2 times 3 minus 1. And this has to be greater than 3, right? So we're checking to see what the outcome is here, right? 2 times 3 is 6 minus 1 is 5. And 5 is greater than 3. So this works. So this is legit. If you want to test a number that doesn't work here, let's try it out. Let's pick the number 1, right? So we're going to do the same thing. 2 times 1 minus 1. We need it to be greater than 3, right? So let's just check. 2 times 1 is 2 minus 1 is 1. Is 1 greater than 3? No, it's not, right? But we already knew that because any number on this side of 2 is not going to work for the original equation. And that would be your answer. Okay. I hope that works. I hope that answers your question. I hope you did it right. Right. I hope you got this right. Fun. And on this camera, we're getting the sun shining as well. So that's probably throwing it off a little bit. Thanks, Yucho. You're welcome. Did you get it right? A dwarf, did you get it right? I hope so. I hope you got it right. And should we continue with conflicts? Any more math questions? Mathematics? Should we do mathematics? We got like another 15 minutes or so, 10 minutes or so left on this stream, and then we're going to do another one. So if you do have any math questions that are longer questions or anything you want to go over, then we're going to do another live stream, again, open discussion math or whatnot, at 4:30, basically an hour and a half from now, right? So let's go through the rest of the comic books I've been reading. These are just my reading comics that I'm not bagging, boarding, and just laying around, right? Now, another comic book publisher that I check out a lot is Aftershock Comics, right? And Aftershocks have been putting out some fantastic books. And this is one of them. I didn't read this before I picked it up. I didn't. I thought that you flip the sign when dividing. Oh no, you only flip the sign if you divide or multiply by a negative number, right? When it is actually only when multiplying or dividing by a negative number. Yeah, to do STEM, you have to be curious. STEM is what is it? Science. I don't know what the T stands for. Technology. E. I don't know what the E stands for, but the M stands for math. You have to be curious. I think we're all born curious. I think human beings are curious. To study music, you have to be curious to see what type of music you can create and the different sounds that come at you, right? So I think human beings were born curious. That is our mission in life, to learn, to grow, to experience, and to create. Now, what our education system does, unfortunately, and our society in general does, the first thing it does, it takes curiosity and crushes it, right? It makes making mistakes a bad thing. Like, the way we learn is by making mistakes. If we did everything correct, right, in our lives, that means we know everything, so there is nothing new to learn. So there is no curiosity because we know everything. We're never making mistakes. So our education system, when you start making mistakes, you get punished for them. Not, you know, some, if you have a good teacher, they'll direct you and correct you and explain to you why certain things may work a certain way instead of the way you thought they work, but in general they give you marks and they say bad, bad student, right? And slowly, if you continuously get bad, 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 you stop asking questions, you stop participating. So they take away curiosity, right? And they pigeonhole people. It's unfortunate. It's disappointing. Some people will say that life gets in the way and they aren't as curious. It's not life that gets in the way. It's society control mechanisms that get in the way. It's people's choice. And really, I'm a little harsh on this. Teachers that are positive and have patience makes such a difference. It's insane. Yeah, huge, huge. As far as what you mentioned is life curiosity. What was I going? Disappointing. Some people blah 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 get life, and it's our society that takes curiosity away. Okay, and it's a form of control. It's a control mechanism. Okay, and that's one thing people have to appreciate. And a lot of people use that excuse, the way our society set up, the way our education system set up, to not take responsibility for their actions, right? To not take responsibility for their own well-being and their own state of mind and their own desires, right? So when they try to do something and they have to go through hurdles to be able to get to where they're going, maybe learn mathematics, maybe learn a language, maybe get a certificate, maybe get fill in applications, go through a process, the song and dance that you have to go through, the obstacles that society are, it's not even society, is those in power that have put into place to prevent you from being who you were meant to be. Once people point to all the obstacles put in front of them by control mechanisms to sort of use as an excuse for not being who they can be, right? They use them as a scapegoat, saying, oh, these people prevented me from doing something, that's why I'm not doing it. These people, the education system sucks, that's why I don't know mathematics. The education system sucks, that's why I don't know how to read and write properly. Once people don't take that responsibility on themselves and put it on others, then that, in my opinion, is what really takes life away from people, takes curiosity away from people, because they have an out, right? They're playing the victim, right? That's the problem with our Western society. Everybody wants to be a victim, right? It wasn't my fault. Well, if it wasn't your fault, do something about it. I'm being harsh, but I think we need a little harshness in our lives. We should teach more critical thinking. There should be a class on just what science is. 100% agree with you. 100% agree with you. Right now, the way it's working is our education system is making science a religion. They're saying, oh, science says this, therefore it is absolute. Well, science changes. Science is a way of experimenting, right? Looking at a situation and going through point form and making sure whatever you're experiencing using the scientific method can be recreated, right? So I was recently, a few weeks ago, I was talking with someone. They were saying that I won't go into the specifics of it, but they were saying that certain people have come out and they changed their perspective on things that they had stated 20 years ago, and that was wrong. Well, that is not wrong, because we know a lot more about science, about the world around us as compared to 20 years ago, right? So science should continuously be evolving. So I 100% agree with you, Miles, that we should teach a whole class on what science is and the scientific method, not just what we've learned by using the scientific method, but the actual method itself. And that should be constantly reviewed every 2 years or so, right? One of the things I learned that got me going into geophysics was my earth science teacher in grade 11. It was the same teacher that I had as geology grade 12, right? And one thing he told me, which was brilliant, that made me realize how little we know, was that when he was in university in the 1960s, when it was 25 years after information was made available based on military records from World War II, right? And in World War II, submarines, US submarines, and submarines from other countries were collecting data from the ocean floor, right? They were collecting gravitational, geomagnetic, all kinds of data from the ocean floor. And 25 years, there's a 25 year sort of a seal on anything that the military does, and then they release the information. So in the 1960s, this information got released. And what they started seeing was striations in the seabed, right, seafloor. And the striation correlated with the seafloor splitting and the magnetic poles flipping, right? And what he said was, he was in university, and one day his professor came in and said, okay, everyone bring out your textbooks. So they brought out your textbooks. And what the prof said was, okay, go to chapter 10 to 13. So everyone went to chapter 10, you know, 10 to 13. He says, okay, grab it, tear that stuff out, throw it in the garbage, right? Because that stuff is irrelevant now, because it is wrong, because we have new information telling us about the continental drift, right? That is science. We should be changing our perspective, improving our understanding of the world constantly. And when information comes to us where we learn something new that makes something obsolete, then we should be willing to change our frame of mind, change our perspective on things. It's amazing that gravitational waves were discovered 100 years after Einstein predicted them. Yeah, that was super cool, eh? That was a year ago or 2 years ago that we actually had the measurement of the gravitational wave going through, right? Amazing. There's so much we don't know about the universe, about us, so much we don't know about human consciousness, because governments had criminalized certain types of activity, right? So hopefully we're past the dark ages. As Robert Anton Wilson would say, we're just coming out of the dark ages now, just coming out of them. Okay, so on that note, gang, we still have this many comic books to go through, and this is an hour stream, and we're going to do another stream at 4:30 in about an hour and a half. So how about we call it there, and then we'll come back in about an hour and a half and do more mathematics, life, whatever it is, right? In the US. Was it measured in the US? I believe so. Or was it Europe? I can't remember who the scientists were that measured this. But it was super cool. Oops. Didn't know, meant to type that. Oops. No, okay. So what time? Yeah, it's 3 o'clock. So we'll do another live stream at 4:30 PST or PDT my time. Okay. Thank you for the math question, by the way. Who was it that asked it? Adorf. Thank you for the math question. It's good to do at least one math question during these math live streams, right? So that's fun. And definitely always a pleasure talking about comic books. And if you guys can make it at 4:30, I'll see you guys at 4:30. If you can't, I'll see you guys in future stream. Assisted Sage 4. Hello, Assisted. We're about to end the stream. We're going to be back in an hour and a half if you can make it. Okay. And for most of the stream, we talked about comic books and we did a little bit of mathematics. In an hour and a half, we'll do a little bit more comic books and more mathematics. Okay. Thanks for popping by. I'll see you guys in about an hour and a half or in future streams. Bye for now.